Thank you for joining us here at Legacy Church Online. Our prayer is that you were inspired by the message and that you were encouraged today. If you'd like to help continue to give financially, you can do so on the website, or many others have even dropped it off here at the church. We appreciate your generosity. We appreciate everything that you're doing. We would also love for you to connect with us. Connect with us on Facebook. Connect with us on Instagram. Go to our website. Send us an email. However you can get connected with us, we want to stay connected with you. We love you. We thank you. And we cannot wait to meet with you in person again.
There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. Stand against the power of my God. praise a hallelujah. In the presence of my enemy, I raise a hallelujah, louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
together this morning. Lift him up today. God, we thank you today, Father. We bless your name today, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's exactly what hallelujah means, is to lift up infinite praises unto God, or 10,000 praises. And it's a universal word in every language. I didn't know if you understood that or know that or not, but it's a universal word in every language. Praise God. It's a, hey, I'm going to raise a hallelujah. I could say, hey, hallelujah in any language, and people are going to know what it is that I'm talking about and what it is that I'm saying. Now, before we continue to move on with the rest of our service, I want to take a moment to pray for America, to pray for our troops, and to pray for our leaders. As you can tell, our flag is at half mast this morning. It's the only flag I got, but it's at half mast this morning. We're going to get us a good one of these days. But 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1, the scripture says this: I urge you first of all to pray for all people. All people. Do you see that right there? As you make your requests, plead for God's mercy upon them and give thanks. Pray this way for kings, and pray this way for all others who are in authority, so that we can live in peace and quietness in godliness and dignity. Scripture is teaching us right here that we can literally change the world through our prayers. Can you pay attention to that? Can we see that as a body of Christ? Can we connect to that this morning? I want you to bow your heads for just a moment, and I want you to pray with me. Use your voice. Use that weapon that God has given unto you as we pray together this morning. God, I thank you today, God, for our current administration, God, President Biden today, God. I pray today, God, that you will give him the strength and the wisdom today, Father God, to lead this great nation, God. God, lead us back to God. Lead us, God, into right relationship with you, Father God. I ask you today, God, for all of those who are in authority today, God, that you'll keep your hand on them, God, that you will bless them, God, that they will walk in the wisdom of Almighty God. That's what we need in this day and in this hour today, God. You told us in Scripture, God, it's not by might, it's not by force, it's not by power, God, but it's by your Holy Spirit, God. And we pray today, Father God, that you will move expressively today, God, that you will touch us and strengthen us, God. We pray this morning for our troops, God, those who have surrendered their lives, God, under this cause, God, to bring people, God, out of harm's way, God, and to protect us, God. Whether we're in war or in peacetime, God, they have surrendered their lives today, Father God, to step up for each and every one of us, God. We're going to honor them. We're going to thank them. We're going to bless them today, God. I pray for their families today, God, that you will give them supernatural strength, God, supernatural help today, Father God, in their time of need. We're going to thank you, and we believe, God, for you. God, we believe today, Father, that you're going to move, God, expressively today, God, for all of these families and all of these people, all of these leaders who are in authority. We ask you all of these things in the mighty and the wonderful name of Jesus. Can we give him one more good hand clap of praise this morning? Thank you today, God, for moving in our hearts and for moving in our lives, God. God, we pray your protective hand on each and every one of us, God, all of our families. You can be seated this morning in the presence of the Lord. We're so glad that you're here. I want to take a quick moment to welcome you. If you are a guest with us, maybe you're watching us online, or maybe you're here this morning in person, God bless you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. We would love for you to fill out a guest card, turn it in at the Welcome Center. They've got a free book that they would love to put into your hands, and we would love to make a great connection with you. That's why we ask you to do that. We just want to have your information so we can hunt you down. No, I'm just kidding. So we can just connect with you and call you. And many of you guys, you'll receive a phone call connect from one of our pastoral staff team. We're praying for you. We're believing that God's going to move in your heart and move in your life. Now, as the ushers are coming this morning, we want to give you an opportunity as another part of our worship to give is giving unto God, and to watch what God will do in and through your heart. Watch what God will do in and through your life in your giving. We know that God is most faithful. Come on, somebody say a good amen right there. God is forever faithful to each and every one of us, and giving unto his kingdom is our good pleasure. Giving unto his kingdom is something that we are purposed to do. So I challenge you to give and watch what God will do in and through your heart, in and through your life. Pray with us this morning, if you will. God, we're thankful today, God, that we get to take a moment, God, to worship you in our tithes, God, to worship you in our offerings, God, to worship you, God, as we give substantially, God, into your kingdom, God, knowing, God, that you're the author and the finisher of our faith. We pray today, God, that you're going to bless this offering and multiply it for your good pleasure, God, for your good use. We're going to thank you for all that you're going to do. In Christ's name, everybody said amen. God bless you as you give.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of a lie. As you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets fall. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I could see you hide in everything you made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, a syllable empty or void. Once you have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. As you speak, 100 billion creatures catching breath, evolving in pursuit of what you said. If it all reveals your nature, so alive, I can see you hide. Every painted sky, a canvas of your grace. If creation still obeys you, so will I. So will I. So
let's sing this together. If the stars
are made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans rule your greatness, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you, so will I. If the wind goes where you send it, so will I. If the rocks cry out in silence, so will I. If the sum of all our praises still falls shy, then we'll sing again 100 billion.
chased down my heart through all of my failure and pride. On a hill you created the light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. Come on, as you speak, and as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. When you lost your life so I can find it here. If you left the grave behind you so alive, I can see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called. You glad you chose surrender, so alive. I can see you hide a billion different ways. The righteous one, the child you died to save. If you gave your life to love him so. Like you would again 100 billion times. But one measure could amount to your desire. You're the one who never leaves the one behind. Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. With voice this morning. I will build. This morning, one last time, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
I will not be shaken. Can you give him a hand clap of praise this morning? I will not be shaken today, Father God. You are our firm foundation today, Father God. You're our hiding place, God. That's what the scripture teaches us, God, that you're that high space today, Father God, that no enemy can reach us today, God. And I'm thankful for your blessing and your power, God. I'm thankful today, God, for your Holy Spirit right now in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. If you have your Bibles this morning, you can turn to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4 in the Word of God. Genesis chapter 4 in the Word of God. In verse 1. The Bible says, now Adam had sexual relations with his wife, Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, with the Lord's help, I've produced a man. Later, she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd while Cain cultivated the ground. Amen. Abel was a farmer. Cain was a farmer in another arena, right? When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift unto the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best. Somebody say the best. It says, Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. Why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right, but if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at your door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. Father, I thank you for the reading of your word. I pray today, God, that you will touch us and strengthen us today, God, as we talk about supernatural generosity today, Father, God, from our hearts, from our lives, from our spirits, God, from our times of service unto you. We're going to thank you for all that you're going to do. In Christ's name, everybody said, amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Point number one this morning, thank our worship team. We appreciate you guys. God bless you so very much. Our very first point this morning, as we're focusing here on giving unto God supernaturally, God, when God gives, I want to tell you this, God gives in a supernatural way. And one of the first things that we've got to pay attention to is point number one, is that you and I are offering God our very first, and we're offering God our very best. Amen. There are gifts that are amazing unto each of us. And Cain and Abel, they offered unto God some gifts. And we're going to talk about those things. Their gifts were amazing, but it was the heart that God was looking at. Just because we give, it doesn't mean that our heart was right in our giving. Let me give you a case in point. Have you ever given an apology that you didn't mean? Amen. You roll your eyes anyways. You kind of have an attitude about the apology that you gave. Well, each of us, when bringing a gift unto God in the form of an offering, or maybe it's returning unto him the tithe that he has given unto us, and tithe simply means the tenth. Amen. Or maybe we're giving of our time and we're giving of our talents. We can take on a very dangerous and destructive attitude. I've heard people talk about all the time that they have given unto God, and they get real snap and real brash about it. Come on, somebody. Amen. And that's not the right way to do it, because the right spirit is so imperative to be in right standing before God. I may give a gift unto God and I may thank God. God, I thank you for blessing me. Here you go. I give this back unto you, but I may be in the wrong spirit when giving it. And you and I, we can do things because we're human beings. We can do things that please men. Come on, somebody. We can do things that satisfy culture. We can do things to just kind of punch our religious duty clocks, but it's God who weighs our hearts. And as a manager and as a trustee, as a steward of God, I wish to live my life according to his word, according to his order, according to his standard. That is my measuring apparatus. Amen. I could care less what everybody else wants to measure me with. I'm trying to measure my life and the standards that I have before God. I'm going to stand before God and be accountable to him for those things. And if I choose to measure in any other way, I'm measuring with the wrong standards, and I'll never live up to the integrity. I'll never live up to the purity that I can have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, God's job, Scripture teaches us that it's God's job to rebuke the devourer, okay, for my sake, or to rebuke the devil who would try to come to steal from me, to kill out of my life, or to destroy something. Amen. And my job as a Christ follower is to faithfully give. I'm faithfully giving my time. I'm faithfully giving my talent. I'm faithfully giving my treasure. I'm faithfully giving my worship. I'm faithfully giving my devotion unto God. And I don't know about you, but I remind the devil every now and again just how much that God has promised unto me, and how I'm an overcomer in Christ, that I can accomplish anything by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody, we get with me this morning. I can accomplish more than he ever dreamed of, thought of, or imagine, and he can't touch me because I'm on that hided place. I'm on that safety, that space right there that God has placed me. Hallelujah. And as a child of God, God's going to rebuke the devil. God's going to rebuke the devil. He's going to rebuke every other thing that would try to devour my resources. Somebody say a good amen. Amen. Now, my promise is from God. And God is obligated by his very word to open, to pour out, to bless, and to guard my resources. Look at me. There's nothing higher than the truth of God's word. There's no law on the earth. There's no law in some kind of upward heavens or some kind of outer space place. Amen. It's the law of God. There's nothing higher than that truth and nothing higher than that standard. Praise God. And to live, we're in a series. I'm sorry, I may have missed a few things. We're in a series entitled Celebrate for maybe some of you who haven't been paying attention or maybe you hadn't been able to be here, but you can go back to our YouTube channel and get all of those. But we're talking about how to celebrate. Amen. And this morning, we're talking about how to celebrate God in a way of supernatural generosity. So point number two. Amen. Point number two. Here's why we celebrate. God gave us his son. God gave us his first. God gave us his very best. Amen. He gave to each and every one of us the very best of heaven and the very best in all of creation in the Lord Jesus Christ. There was no other gift that God could have given unto us to pacify sin, to destroy its hold on mankind, or dismantle the enemy's work besides Jesus Christ. No other sacrificial gift could pay for mankind's debt in full. I hear a lot of people this day and this time and this hour talk about, well, here's what I'm going to give unto God, and I may or may not give unto him, or I may not give or kind of celebrate his purposes. And I get very concerned because our giving is to be unto God. Come on, somebody. Not to any man, not to any movement. Amen. It's unto God. That's why when I bring my tithe back unto God, it's designated for his use. When I'm giving my time, I'm giving my offerings, they're designated unto God. My time, I offer unto him, and I say, God, utilize my time. Utilize me today. How can I serve you? How can I serve your kingdom? You guys know this about me. Somebody says, hey, Pastor Mike, can I borrow that? Can I use that? My answer is always yes. I'm like, absolutely, you can borrow this. You can have this. You can utilize this because I'm a generous person. You know why? Because God has made me that way. Amen. I wasn't always that way. I was very stingy. And I grew up, you guys know this, I grew up in my biological parents, I have one biological brother, and 187 children went through our home in a period of about 8 years through foster care. I get it, some of them were only there a couple of hours in the afternoon, some of them were only there overnight, some of them lived there many years, okay? But over 187 children went through the system of our home, and I was a very stingy person. In my house still today, there's a cabinet that only I know about where the Little Debbie snacks are. Amen. If there's a special candy bar that I bought from one of the kids from school, you know those caramel candy bars? If anybody's selling those, you see Pastor Mike, he'll buy a case. Praise the Lord. He'll buy a case from you in Jesus' name, all right? And he hides them. Why? Because they're mine. They're mine. I bought them. Can I get one of those? You can have one square. Praise God, in Jesus' name, one square. That's how I do it, okay? I'm a little bit stingy. I can be stingy, but, you know, we give our time. We say, God, here's my time. What can I do to serve you this week? How can I honor you this week? And God, he has gifted each of us with talent. He's gifted each of us with purpose. Have you faithfully surrendered that gift? Have you faithfully surrendered that unto God? I know a lot of people, they give their jobs 100%. They give their family leftovers. Pastor Mike, why is my family struggling? You're giving them leftovers. I know a lot of people. I know a lot of people. They give their family 100% and they give their jobs leftovers. Pastor Mike, I don't understand why I'm struggling at work. I'm struggling because you give it leftovers. There's got to be a good balance there. You got to be a hard worker in Jesus' name. Scripture teaches us that a lazy man shouldn't eat. A man that doesn't provide for his family, the scripture says he's worse than an infidel. He's worse than a sinner. And so there's got to be a balance. I know a lot of people, they give their hobbies 100% and they give God their leftovers. Are you using your talent? Are you giving your purpose unto God's kingdom 100%? Think about this. God has given us healing. God has given us encouragement. God has given us salvation. God has given us life. He's given us peace. He's given us joy. He's given unto each and every one of us the breath that we breathe and the very ground that we walk on. Hallelujah. The scripture teaches that he flung all the stars out into the sky and he calls them by name. I see this in scripture, and we talk about this, how the Bible teaches that God formed the mountains with his hands. He carved the rivers with his fingers, that the clouds are the dust of his feet. Surely he can handle my needs. Surely he can help me handle my home. Surely he can help me handle my career. Somebody say a good amen right there. He can help me. God gave me 206 bones to hold up my structure. He gave me a heart and veins to pump through my system, muscles to help me make every move that I could make. I'm telling you, God gave me a brain. You may be thinking, he shortchanged you, brother. Regardless, God gave me a brain to be able to make sound and solid and well thought out decisions. And God gave us his greatest gift. His one and only son died and shed his life-giving blood for all of mankind. And God did not withhold. If you want to walk in supernatural generosity, don't withhold the gifts back unto God. Don't withhold your talent. Don't withhold your time. Don't withhold your worship. Don't withhold your offerings. God gave first, and God gave with supernatural generosity. Come on, somebody. Amen. Hallelujah. Point number three. Somebody say this with me. Life is more than. All right, and then we're going to say dot, dot, dot. Because it's not a finished statement. Okay, you ready? One, two, three. Some of you guys got a little fast on the dots, Michael Brainerd. I don't want to mention anybody's names, okay? Life is more than. Life is more than. Look at Matthew chapter 6 and verse 24. No one can serve two masters. Do you see that right there? No one can serve two masters. For you will hate the one and love the other. You will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. I love the United States of America. I love the place that we live, the freedoms that we currently have. I love the space that we're walking in, that we can go out. And if we're hard workers and we're developers and we're dreamers, we can have just about anything that we want in this world. Amen? But listen to me this morning. You cannot serve both God and money. Scripture says, that is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life. I don't know about you, but I've been worrying about everyday life. I've been a tad concerned with my mind, a tad concerned, a tad overwhelmed at times thinking about situation and circumstance. And he says, don't worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more? Isn't life more than food? Isn't life worth more than just our clothing? Look at it right there. Your body. Isn't life more than your body, more than clothing? Look at the birds. Look at the birds. They don't plant. They don't harvest. They don't store food in barns. Amen. You can't go down to the local spaces over here, the local rental places. What do you call them? Help me, somebody. Storage units. You can't go down to the local store. Brain freeze, okay? God, I thought you gave me a good brain. These people are making fun of me. In your presence, God. You can't go down to the local storage units and see a bunch of birds hanging out storing all their grain. A bunch of squirrels hanging out storing all their grain. Look at it right here. It says, look at, they don't plant, they don't harvest, they don't store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? The Bible says that if a bird hits the ground, God knows about it. Come on, somebody. He says on down in verse 32, these things, what things? More than food, more than clothing, all of life, the worries, the cares, the frustrations of this life in verse 32. These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your heavenly Father already knows all of your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and God will give you everything that you need. We ought to give him a hand clap of praise right there, because he is promising his people something. Hallelujah. Now watch here, verse 25. There's three things that we would lose if we did not have food and clothing. Amen. Three things that we would lose. Number one, we would lose some pleasures. Food tastes good. Food good. I could have been a great caveman. I'm just telling you right now. Food good. Amen. It's pleasurable to eat. Food gives us health and food gives us life. Amen. I think it's like 40 to 70 days. If you don't have the right amount of food, 40 or 70 days, you're a dead person. It's only a few days without water, but anyways. Secondly, you'll lose some human praise and admiration, admiring glances if we didn't have nice clothes. Hello? Some of us really picked that up in junior high. This guy, he made fun of me, you know, whatever, so I really got to have the best of the best. And we went logo happy. You know, we went logo happy with life. I got to have all of the best of things, right? Third, we would lose long life if we had no food at all or weren't protected from the elements with clothes and shelter. And here's how Jesus responds this way. This is so good. Life was not given primarily for physical pleasures, but for something greater, the enjoyment of God. Hello? Life was not given primarily for the approval of man, but for something greater, the approval of Almighty God. Life was not given primarily for living on this earth, but for something greater, eternal life with God. We should celebrate that. That should be a part of what we're thinking about each and every hour of each and every day. Hallelujah. Now look at verse 26. The birds, this is not a lesson of laziness, okay? The birds have to dig the worms. The birds got to go seize the bugs, and they've got to go cushion their nests with strings and leaves. I was telling you guys about this. I got this hole in the side of my house, this tiny little hole that this little bird family decided to move in on me this summer and wanted to live there. And this little bird, he got on the lights. He's got on the light. We got this light cord outside. He's hanging out on the light cord. And if I get too close, he's chirping at me and he's going, number one, I let you live in my space. And then you're going to chirp at me like that? You're going to be all rude and stuff? While your wife's on the inside of my house giving birth. Hello? All right? He's cushioning their nest. He's bringing them food. He's doing all these things. Amen. And he's just popping in. He's being a rude neighbor. Praise God. He's being a rude neighbor. That's exactly what's going on. But I let him live there. I let him live there because I'm a generous person, right? I'm going to fix it this fall, though. He's not going to be coming back. Amen. I'm going to evict him. May put a birdhouse out there, though. But in all of this, the scripture says it is God who feeds them. It is God who feeds them. Birds don't anxiously hoard things up for the day that God doesn't show up. Ooh, can I say something to somebody right here? Birds aren't thinking about their 401k. I'm not criticizing anybody. I just want to talk to you about having a supernatural mindset of generosity. Birds, they go about their work as though when the sun comes up tomorrow, God will still be God. God is still going to provide. God is still able. He's exceedingly able. How much more then should we consider the provision and the mercy and the faithfulness? And since we are not mere birds, but we are children of our Heavenly Father. How much more should we consider his provision in our hearts and in our lives? And we, as human beings, have the capacity and the responsibility of honoring God by our faith. And I'm here to tell you this morning that God can be counted upon. Somebody say a good amen right there. Now look back at verse 32. Look back at 32. He's talking about anxiety and being anxious for anything. And I've got to say this to you. Anxiety shows that we're too close to the world and too far away from God. Amen? Because if I'm to walk in peace, and I'm to walk in truth and I'm to walk in everlasting life, then I need not to have that kind of anxiety. And God's will is that you not be anxious about anything, but that you connect to His peace and you connect to His security. And God's Holy Spirit will help you this morning overcome any trial or any anxiousness or any uneasy feelings, any fearful feelings that you have this morning by the power of His Holy Spirit. Amen. And finally, point number four, supernatural generosity. God made a way for all of mankind when He sent His Son Jesus to take away our sin. He made a way for what? He made a way for eternal life. He made a way not just for life, but Scripture teaches us life abundantly. I don't know about you, but I want to walk on the abundant side of life. Amen? I want to live in that frame. So how in the world could I now think or even engage the thought that God would refuse to make a way to help me now? Amen? His wisdom, by His truth. Now all of a sudden God turns selfish in this day, in this age, in this hour. God gives us His one. He gives us His very best. He gives us His only Son. And now all of a sudden He's going to turn selfish and not help and minister to unto His people. Amen. It's ridiculous to think. Now look back to Genesis chapter 4. The offerings of Cain and Abel were polar opposites. Think about this. They were polar opposites when they brought an offering unto God. Cain showed a proud, unbelieving heart. I'm just going to show up whenever it is that I want to. I'm going to give God whatever it is I want to, and God better accept it. That's kind of how Cain was. Amen. I'm going to give whenever I want. This is good enough. Amen. Therefore, Scripture says he and his offering were rejected. Now watch this. He came frustrated. He came prideful. And he came grudgingly giving. Very similar to how I pay my taxes. Grudgingly. I have to do it. And I don't do it with happiness. Come on, somebody give me an amen right here. You may be from the IRS. God bless you. I'd love to take you to lunch today. Just kidding. Just kidding. I'm a generous person. I'd gladly take you to lunch. Amen. We're going to the dollar menu at McDonald's, but I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Let's move on. Let's move on. Now, he came grudgingly. Remember that. He came grudgingly giving. You know, he felt obligated. He felt like his arm was being twisted, so to speak. Abel came as a sinner. He came with his sacrifice expressing humility, expressing sincerity. Here's how I'm giving my gift. And his obedience was blessed as he offered God his first and his very best. Abel offered in belief. He offered in value. He offered in gratefulness. He gave cheerful and he gave repentant. Amen? And in every age and time, there have only been two types of worshipers. Cain type or Abel type. Cain's or Abel's. Cain type generosity, who they're proud, they're hardened despisers of the gospel method of salvation. They're attempting to please God in ways of their own devising. So they're constantly trying to create some kind of new religion or some kind of new way unto God. There's only one way unto God, and it's through the man Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Or Abel type generosity, which are humble believers who draw near to God in the way that he has revealed. And so we see this because Cain was mad at God, but Cain indulged malignant anger against Abel. You guys know Cain can't kill God, but Cain can still do something about his anger. He's not handling it in the right way, but here he goes. He harbors this evil spirit of discontentment and rebellion against God. And I'm telling you this morning, there is not an angry, envious, or fretful look. There's no eye rolling or thought that escapes God's observing eyes. God reasons with us rebels, declaring, if you'll come to me in the right way, you will be accepted. When we bring an offering unto God, we bring some worship unto God. When we come to God in the right way, it will be be accepted. And a lot of people, when choosing to walk in their own ways, refusing submission to God, they begin that Cain flesh-filled perspective. I will give what I want, when I want, and how I want, and God needs to accept it. I'm only going to give God this week 15 minutes of my time. I'm only going to read a devotion. I'm only going to be verse of the day kind of Christianity. Amen. I know that there's a good place to start, and the good place to start is verse of the day Christianity. But you got to grow up and put on your big boy pants. Come on, somebody. You got to grow up in the fullness of God and begin serving those around and about you. Hallelujah. And while Abel's supernatural generosity differs greatly, he considers God as his source. He considers God as his guidance, his mercy, and his provision. And Abel knew that he was accountable to God, and he connected himself to that giving perspective. Hallelujah. Now, Cain murders his brother Abel in a moment of rage. And when God confronts Cain, he let Cain know that Abel's blood had been crying out to him from heaven. From the earth. And he was hearing it in heaven. Now, what did the blood of Abel cry out for? Judgment, justice, condemnation, vengeance, a curse. And thousands of years later, we see the Son of God was systematically tortured and killed in a bloody, violent act. And Hebrews tells us that the blood of Christ speaks a better word. Hallelujah. It speaks a better word than all of the Old Testament, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if the blood of Jesus Christ is speaking, what is it saying to us this morning? It's crying out grace, and it's crying out mercy, and it's crying out salvation, and it's crying out forgiveness, and it's crying out peace. Come on, it's crying out restoration and healing and deliverance. Hallelujah. The blood of Christ covers the guilty, the broken, and the wounded, shielding them from guilt, releasing them from shame, and healing them from despair. And it is crying out a supernatural generosity word, a supernatural word. Hallelujah. You know, in a few verses later in the book of Genesis, right there, chapter 4 that we've been studying, verse 13, God gives Cain his punishment. And Cain replies to the Lord, "My punishment is too great for me to bear. It's too great for me to bear." Now, I don't have a lot of time to go into it, but what was happening was Cain was being separated from the presence of God forever. He was being separated from the presence of God. And Cain was upset. He was mad. And he says, "My punishment is too great for me to bear." But what Cain was really mad about, what Cain, he really wasn't apologetic at the situation. He wasn't really repentant. He was displaying no regard for his sin against his brother, his parents, or against God. He was mad at his punishment. He was frustrated. And it's just like the devil to get us to focus on how we're treated and how we might suffer ourselves and to not focus upon what we've done unto others. Our final scripture this morning, Isaiah chapter 32 and verse 8. This is so good. This is so good. "But generous people plan to do what is generous, and they stand firm in their generosity." Let me read it to you again. "Generous people plan to do what is generous, and they stand firm in their generosity." Why? Because the providence of God will reward us. Why? Because the grace of God will give us abundant satisfaction and confirmed peace. Why? Because what distresses and frightens others shall not disturb the generous. Our heart is secured upon our God. This is God's way. Our tithing, our giving, our worship, our offerings, our time, our service, our talent, lifting up the kingdom of God together, our missions, our compassion for others is all tied unto our hearts. God is weighing the heart. And the Holy Spirit is moving this morning. He is in the heart condition ministry. Hallelujah. He's in the heart condition situation. And God reads our hearts. And God reads our minds. And God reads our motives better than any CAT scan or MRI you've ever heard of. And the Holy Spirit is here today to deal with the issues of our heart. Would you stand with me all over the building this morning? As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, just for a moment of reverence. It's just a moment of reverence between you and God. I believe that the Holy Spirit is speaking unto hearts and lives today. You might be saying, Pastor Mike, I don't know Jesus Christ as my Lord, and I have not received Him as my Savior. You say, I want to know Him today. I want to say yes to Jesus. I know that He has said yes unto me, but I want to say yes unto Him. And Pastor, I need to surrender my life unto Christ this morning. I need to surrender my life unto Christ this morning. If that's you this morning, can I just see your hand? Pastor, that's me. I don't know Christ as my Lord. I don't know Him as my Savior. God bless you, sir. God bless you, ma'am. God bless you. Anyone else under the sound of my voice this morning? I want to pray with you, and you are welcome to pray this prayer of faith with me as our prayer team comes. If you need special prayer for anything, listen to me, anything. You say, I'm going through a financial situation. I'm going through a mental situation. I'm going through some anxiety and some frustration and some fear. Our prayer team is here that they might be able to pray with you and encourage. Every one of us needs prayer at time in our hearts and times in our life. And if you need prayer for anything, we want you to come. We want you to grab a hold of one of these prayer leaders and say, hey, I need you to pray with me about this situation. We're going to move on into that in just a moment. But for those of you that don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you to pray this prayer of faith and repeat after me. Christians, you're welcome to pray this prayer with heartfelt sincerity. I pray this prayer all the time just to get myself back focused on God and focused upon all that God has done unto my heart and done unto my life. I challenge you to just pray this prayer and repeat it after me and just pray it with sincerity from your own heart. Say these words. God, I thank you, Lord, for this day. I thank you, Father, for your word. I want to receive Jesus as my Lord, and I want to receive Him as my Savior. I know that He came, that He shed His blood, that He was resurrected from the dead, all to rescue me. And I receive Him right now to be my King, to be my Lord, to be my Savior. God, I thank you for your Son, Jesus. And Jesus, I thank you for your blood. Forgive me of my sin and make me a new creation. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. And everybody said, amen. Can we celebrate the kingdom of God? Can we celebrate people coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ right now? Thank you today, Father. Thank you today, Father. Thank you today, Father. What an impactful moment. We've got a starter kit for you, a starter kit. Pastor Mike, I want to know more about my faith. I want to know more about the next steps that I made. We've got some starter kits. See one of the prayer team. They'd be glad to get that unto you this morning. Now listen, if you're under the sound of my voice and you say, Pastor Mike, I want to experience that supernatural generosity that you were talking about. I want to be able to give my time and my talent and my treasures back unto God. I want my heart to be right before God. I want to be an able kind of worshiper and not a Cain type of worshiper. God, I want to bring you a surrendered heart and a repentant heart and a forgiving heart. God, a heart that needs rescue today, God, not a hardened heart like Cain. If that's you this morning, can I just see your hand? Pastor, I've been anxious about a lot of things. I've been frustrated about a lot of things. Hands all over the building. Hands all over the building. I challenge you to take a few moments in prayer right now. Take a few moments to just honor God. Take a few moments to say, God, I want to be that type of able worshiper. I challenge you to come up front. Maybe you want to come up front and worship God and take a moment as we're praying and singing and leading some worship. I challenge you to find that place to draw closer unto God. Can we do that for just a few moments right now? Begin to give God that gift of worship. Come on. Every hand raised this morning, let's lift up the name of Jesus. Let's worship together. Let's take one more moment to lift His name up.
There's a grace when the heart is on fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where we used to be and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fight, standing next to me. There was another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need a reminder of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my dead left and dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world.
Joy come every
joy come every battle. Oh, that's where you'll be.
Count the joy come every battle.
I know that's where you'll be.
Count the joy come every battle.
I know that's where you'll be.
I count the joy come every battle. I know that's where you'll be.
Let's sing this together this morning. This is how I find my battles. Oh, this is how I find my battles. Oh, this is how I find my battles. Oh, this is how I find my battles. Come on, it may look. Like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my. This is how I find my battles. This is how I find my battles. This is how I find my battles. Come on, it may look. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
You feel surrounded by him this morning. You feel surrounded by his presence and his power. God, we celebrate you today, Father God. Hallelujah, God, we celebrate you today, Father God. Even if, God, Lord, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, God, they choose to throw us into the fiery furnace, I know, God, that you will be surrounding us, God, that your presence is going to rescue us today, Father God. God, that even the king of this world, he may look down into that fire and say, didn't I throw three men into the fire? I see a fourth, and he looks like the Son of God. And I pray today, God, that you give us that kind of confidence, God, and that kind of faith, God, that kind of power, God, that kind of Holy Spirit strength, God. We're going to thank you today, Father, for all that you're going to do today, God. I pray that you're going to touch your people, encourage your people, strengthen your people today, God. We're going to bless you and praise you for it. This week, God, is going to be a week of supernatural generosity, God. We're not only going to feel it from you, God, we're going to give it out to those around and about us, God. We're going to bless people and minister unto them everywhere that we go and in everything that we do. We know that we're going to be ministered to by you in the name of Jesus. Everybody said, amen, amen. Next month, we start a series entitled Watch Your Mouth. Watch Your Mouth. It's going to be a fun time next week, next month, okay? And don't forget about all the things that are coming up, the men's event, the ladies' event, and the tailgate party. Hey, we love you. We appreciate you. The three-minute rule is in effect. Get around, shake somebody's hand, greet somebody, say, I'm so glad to see you here. Thank you for being here. God bless you. I hope and pray that you have a great week.